I need what I need. The Bible said, seek and ye shall find. Come on, I was going to come right in the middle of you, but you're never going to know what you're looking for until the Holy Ghost begins to locate it for you and you begin to seek after it. I don't know what it's going to take to have a move in the bottom of my life, little Chris. I don't know what it's going to take to change my circumstances, but what I do know is it will be committed. And I'm searching after God and seeking after Him.
Pastor,
What is the very minimum that I can get by with and go to heaven? Come on, I'm going to preach it anyway. I don't need no response. I'm going to preach it anyway. When people ask me, oh, is that really a heaven or hell issue? What they are asking is, what is the least that I can do for God and still be saved? What is the least that I can do for God and still be the person that I am? Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you something. That I'm not satisfied with walking on the edge. And I'm not satisfied with seeing how close to the world that I can get and still be saved. I want to see how close to God that I can get. I want to see how close to the anointing that I can get. I want to see how close to the spiritual realm of seeing miracles, signs, and wonders I can get. Because I'm not living with just the bare minimum. I want to know, God, what can I do to have more of you? I'm going to preach something to our young people just for a moment. You get mad at Pastor, but by the Bible, you got to get glad in the same riches. You got to love me to go to heaven. So if you get mad, you better get it in your mind that you're going to get happy too. But I will tell you what we need. We need more young people knocking on doors. We need more young people asking our elders, how can I help you this week? What can I do? What can I do to be a servant? We need more of our young people that are walking around picking up trash instead of throwing it down. We need more young people that are willing to pick up a toy for us and scroll and say, I just want to be a servant in the kingdom of God. Not because that's going to save you or any such, but because I want to do more for the kingdom of God. I want to improve my anointing. I want the overflow of impartation to be spilled upon the church house. And it's never going to happen if I'm not willing to be a servant.
That's right.
Oh. And all the young people say, I still love you, preacher.
I still love you.
Amen. Those that didn't say that can now stand up and say, I love you, Pastor. We had 100% cooperation. Just the way I like it. If we want God's blessings, we can't sit around and wait on them.
Right.
We're confused by the scripture. I've been blowing a little philosophy. I'm trying to wind down, I promise. We're confused by the scripture. And in fact, we started living it with Christ. And it said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. And here's what we look like. They that wait. On the Lord. We're confused by that. Because we think that that means sit down, shut up, and just wait on God to get there. But if you will look it up in the original Hebrew, when King James translated it, he translated it serve. Anybody ever been to a restaurant, not like McDonald's, but an actual sit-down restaurant where you have somebody that comes by and waits? You either call them a waiter if he is a male, or a waitress if she is a female. And they come by and they say, sir, I'll be taking care of you this afternoon. What would you like to drink? Can we start you off with yada, 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 yada? I want sweet tea. Okay, we're going to take these drink orders. Would you like an appetizer? If you like that, we'll get that in the order for you, then we'll come back and we'll wait on you. And as they come back, I've got it in my mind, and I want the biggest, nastiest steak that you can get in this place, and I want you to ring it out 3 times, throw it on the grill, flip it over, count to 30, flip it again, bring it to me, knock the horns off of it, wipe his nose, put him on a plate, it's time to eat a steak.
I like it.
And they come back around. Here's your steak. How is it? Oh man, that thing's still alive. I didn't want it like that. Well, it's not a problem, sir. We'll take it back to the kitchen. We'll warm it up for you and bring it back out. Bring it back out. Oh my God, did you have to burn it? Oh, it's no problem, sir. Well, what, how can we make this better? Would you like another steak? No, I'll eat the steak. But the whole time, they're being nice to me. They're being kind to me. They're waiting on me. Because no matter how bad I want my experience to be, They are paid to make my experience good. While I'm on the subject, this has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. But if you go out to a restaurant and you embarrass me, I will get up and leave right in your presence. Because there's no such thing, no excuse for rude Pentecostals. Or any other denomination. You go to that restaurant, you don't know what that young lady who's waiting on you is dealing with that day. She may be the single mother of six. She may be getting threatened. Her power bill will be cut off. He may be threatened with being kicked out of the street. You don't know. But I do know one thing. She's there to wait on you. And if things are not the way you want, there's ways of handling that. Trust me. There are ways of getting good service without getting your food spit on. Which is exactly what you do every time you send something back and you're rude. That just helps somebody. That just helps somebody. You ain't never going to send nothing else back, are you? And Jesus said, they that wait upon the Lord. But Chris, I need you to say it. Jesus, I'm glad to be in service with you today. I'm glad you're here. What can I do for you today? What can I do for you? Oh, you want praise? Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Your name is to be praised. What was that? You want worship, oh God? From the depths of my heart, oh Lord, I pour out my spirit unto you. What was that, God? You want to see miracles and wonders? Okay, I'm going to find a need because it's my desire to wait upon you. Lord, here's a need right now. Kneel down. Here's a need right now. God, I want to see your presence. I want to see your anointing. What, Lord, you need something else. God, you need something. I want to tell you, Lord, whatever it is that you need, God, that's what I'm willing to do. Because, God, I want to wait on you. My God, I feel the Holy Ghost filling this room up right now. God, whatever it is that you need, Lord, I'm willing to do it because I know that the problem is not your lack of power. It's my lack of sensitivity. Serving the Lord is not when you walk outside those doors and tell everybody I'm a Christian. That's not serving God. Serving God is not when you go out into the world and you tell the world, hey, look at me. I'm a Pentecostal. I don't live out of God. That's not serving God. But serving God. So when you come to the house of the Lord, sit surrender, and you see somebody with me. She's got me. She's got this in me. Now here's obvious. We didn't have it yesterday. She's got this in me. No more sermon. No more I can say. God, use me. Use me, Jesus. We're never more like Christ than we are in servanthood. And we're never less like Christ when we're in judgmental state. I'm trying to help somebody in this place today. I feel this in the Holy Ghost. If you want to be like God, you've got to find a place of servanthood. God hasn't changed. And likely he is, neither has your circumstances. And the only way that any of that is ever going to become different is when I am willing. I'm here to serve you. Whatever it is, what you have. Because this is what a need looks like when God blesses his covenant. When you begin to serve God, this is what you get in return. The anointing.
The anointing. This is my jacket. There's no anointing in it, I promise you. There's probably a lot of stings in it. There's no anointing in it. This is what it looks like when you come to God with a thing. You say you're going to start his anointing.
Gosh. You don't understand. I need to borrow you just for a moment. This is not her life story, but I'm just going to make one up for you real quick. You don't understand, preacher. My life has been so bad. It's been tainted by so much darkness. My life has been destroyed. I want you to kneel just for a second. I want you to kneel with one man. Lord, you don't understand how bad my life has been. God, you don't understand. You can't accuse me. My reputation is not what it should be. My reputation, Lord, I don't have a good reputation. And God says, you don't understand.
To the throne of God.
has covered you. Give me a jacket. Brother Brian, come here just for a moment. I just need you for a while. You're going off to college. God's been good to you, man. You know that religious girl. When you get to college, and somebody says, oh, you've been brainwashed by Pentecost. You remind them, I haven't been brainwashed, I've been blood washed. I've been covered. I need about five or six people right now to join me at these altars. It doesn't matter what your life has looked like. Doesn't matter where you come from. What matters is that you didn't come. Doesn't matter your circumstances. Because I've come to wait. My strength is going to be renewed. Come on, church. I need some help. Come on, church. I need some help. I know the hell has released itself this church. I know we're fighting spiritual warfare greater than we ever have. I know that we're fighting battles. I understand all that. But God is wanting to cover today the wounds and the violence. You don't know the people that are standing in this audience right now who have deep spiritual scars. And if you can see with your spiritual eyes, you can see they've been mutilating their spirits. You would see that their spirits have just been almost destroyed. God is wanting to cover you today. So what I'm asking, if you will step out by faith. Come on, I feel a pulling in your heart right now. I know exactly where I am. God called me to pastor this church, not just to preach, but I know exactly where you are today, and I know exactly who I'm talking to. God's pulling and tugging at your heart right now. You've been wounded. You've been bruised. God's pulling at you right now. God's pulling at you right now. He's just wanting you to serve Him. He's just wanting you to come and be covered by His blood. Come on, every hand in this place lifted right now. Voices lifted, talking to God. God, I pray for strength right now. Lord, I pray, God, that you would reach down. Lord, that you would draw unto you. Draw nigh unto you, oh God, those that are burdened. Those that are weary. Those that are troubled, Lord. Come. God's calling you. God's pulling at your heart. You know I'm preaching to you. You know I'm talking to you right now.
Be covered by His presence. Be covered.
done. You don't understand what my grandparents brought me through. You don't understand what my aunts and uncles have done to me, God. Preacher, you don't understand what my wife or my husband has put me through. What I